A PDF of recipes contained in the book accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Name Drop, the really good celebrity stories I usually only tell at happy hour, by Ross Mathews. Read by the author.
Is dedicated to everyone who never got to sit at the cool kids' table in the cafeteria. You can sit at my table anytime, but you have to share your tater tots. Name drop defined. It's a verb. The habit of mentioning names of famous people that you, quote, know, end quote, in order to make yourself seem more fabulous by association. Name drop used in a sentence. I, Ross Mathews, would never name drop. Ugh, it's tacky. My best friend Gwyneth Paltrow taught me that. Okay, this is the prologue. I'm in Palm Springs, which is, you know, my mothership. My favorite place in the entire world. I have a cocktail here just like it should be. I hope you are doing the same somewhere as you're listening to this. Here we go. Let's get started. Name dropping runs rampant in Hollywood, like high-speed car chases, gluten intolerance, and syphilis. And much like syphilis, name-dropping is super grody, and it spreads quickly. You can't walk 5 feet down Sunset Boulevard without overhearing some real housewife of whatever telling a former Disney tween about how her new trainer is the guy who got Chris Pratt's body into bat-shit crazy shape for that comic book movie. No, not that comic book movie, the other one. No, not that one, the other one. Side note, Chris, if you're listening to this, and I just assume you are, I love your body of work. Oh, honey, I'd guard your galaxy any day. Side note, I'd like to point out that I made a conscious choice not to make a cheap, tasteless Uranus joke here. Why? Because I'm trying to be bigger than that. We'll see how long that lasts. As someone who has interviewed just about every celebrity you can imagine on every red carpet you can imagine for nearly the past 2 decades, I have some pretty amazing stories. Oh, and trust me, the red carpet stories? Those are the boring ones. The stories where I actually get invited into celebrities' secret lives. Their natural habitats, if you will. Those are the real gold. Their private tables and restaurants. Their magnificent movie trailers. Their hilariously humongous houses. That is where the really good stuff happens. From time to time, I've managed to sneak beyond the velvet rope that separates them from us mere mortals and see what few ever get to see. The following Hollywood stories are wholesome and hilarious. No celebrity was harmed in the making of this book. Oh, but don't worry, honey. We're still going to go there. I mean, don't you want to know what Kanye piled onto his plate at the buffet when I was in line behind him at the Kardashian Christmas party? And who would have heard if I told you? Ham. It was ham. See, now you know, and nobody died. Well, the pig did, but you can't blame me for that. No one ever specifically told me not to tell these stories, but I never do. Unless you take me to happy hour and ply me with cheap two-for-one cocktails and appetizers. What can I say? I'm a total whore for an hors d'oeuvre. The idea for this book hit me as I was hanging out with a fun group of friends. Some old friends, some new friends, some friends who, thanks to Botox, look new. After about 4 skinny margaritas, well, I was only going to have 3, but hello, they're 2 for 1. I told one of these exceptionally juicy stories and noticed my friends, their mouths agape, hanging on my every word. When I finished narrating, one of them said, "You have to put that in a book." To which I indignantly replied, "I could never." And then I asked myself the same question I did when I was offered skinny margaritas number 5 and 6. Why not? You should also know that in true Ross Mathews spirit, I've taken the liberty of creating a corresponding cocktail and a related recipe, or Rossipe, as I call them, for each chapter. I mean, why should Martha Stewart have all the fun? Now, what other book has done that for you, huh? Go up in Moby Dick! There's not a single recipe in there, not even for fish sticks. I know, I was shocked too. No wonder nobody ever read it. So, here we go. Let's get this soon-to-be classic piece of literature started. Pretend it's happy hour, and you and I are sitting at the bar. I look amazing, and I agree with you, much thinner in person. You look good, too. Maybe it's the candlelight, maybe it's the booze. Either way, let's just go with it. Just lean in, keep this all between you and me, and do me a favor. Don't judge me if I name drop just a little. Thanks. I promise this book will be out of this world. Just like Uranus. Oh, damn it! Chapter 1. The Lady Gaga Story. First, here's your cocktail. It's called A Starfruit Martini is Born. Here's how you make it. Do like half a fresh starfruit, which is that fruit you may have never bought, but it's like always in the grocery store. Half a lemon. 2 teaspoons of simple syrup, which is equal parts water and sugar. You heat the sugar until it's dissolved. Heat it all together. Then 1.5 ounces of vodka and 3/4 ounces of triple sec. So, then combine the peeled starfruit and squeeze a lemon juice into a martini shaker with the simple syrup and muddle it together, which just means sort of like smush it together. Then add the vodka, add the triple sec and ice, shake it, and strain it into a martini glass. That is how a starfruit martini is born. I pride myself on 2 things. First, I have the absolute best 7-layer bean dip recipe of all time. And second, I have the absolute best Lady Gaga story of all time. And much like my bean dip, this story has several layers. It's very satisfying and maybe a bit too cheesy. Great. Now I'm hungry. I love Gaga. The public knows her very well by now, but when she first burst onto the mainstream around 2008, it was like a glamorous alien had landed on Earth and taken over. I've never seen anything like it in my life. In what seemed like 30 seconds, we all went from living in a world where Gaga was just something a baby said, to literally every person in the world knowing who Lady Gaga was. Like, everyone. Like, even my mom. Gaga really sealed the deal for me when she arrived at the 2011 Grammy Awards red carpet inside a giant intergalactic egg. No yolk. That was when Gaga really came out of her shell. I'm sorry, egg jokes just always crack me up. I'll never forget watching as that egg slowly opened and Gaga emerged, dozens of hard-boiled photographers scrambling to get a shot of her. Oh, and don't even get me started on that infamous meat dress she wore to the MTV Video Music Awards. Now, I have no beef with that look. As a gay man who has battled with my weight for my entire life, there's no one who can appreciate low-carb couture more than me. Oh, little known fact. That meat dress is currently on display at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Okay. Maybe it's in a giant Tupperware container or a meat locker or something. Is it beef jerky now? And is it just hanging there on display all alone, or does it come with your choice of sides? Would you like the Natalie Coleslaw, some Tina Turnips, or a heapin' helpin' of Cardi Beans? But I digress. Back to Lady Gaga and the day we finally met. Aside from being Liza Minnelli's best friend or the guy who measures Justin Timberlake's inseam, being a judge on RuPaul's Drag Race is the best job in the world. I love my co-stars, the amazing queens, and the surprise of which superstar guest judge I'll be sitting next to on the judges panel any given week. I'll never forget the first day of taping for season 9. I sprinted into the Drag Race studio, carrying my signature bold print blazer in a garment bag in one hand, and an iced venti Americano with extra ice, just a splash of non-fat milk, and exactly 1.5 Splendas in the other. For some reason, though, things seemed, different that day. Was it just me, or was everyone being overly secretive? I couldn't help feel like something was up. Had Rue gone brunette this season? Had they replaced me with Randy Rainbow? Was Shangela back? Again? I kept hearing producers talking in hushed tones, but I couldn't understand what they were saying. They kept repeating something about LG. LG will be on the main stage. What? LG? The appliance company? Are they a new sponsor? LG will be ready in 30 minutes. Is LG our guest judge? I started thinking of who LG could possibly be, Everyone's favorite Gilmore Girl Lauren Graham? That would be cool. Republican Senator Lindsey Graham? I don't think so. Larry the Cable Guy? I know that's a stretch, but... It never once occurred to me that LG could possibly stand for Lady Gaga. It all became clear when the sound person came to mic me for the taping. Now, let me explain something about being mic'd. You become very close with the person clipping that tiny microphone to your collar or lapel or man spanx. Oftentimes, they have to run the cord down your shirt or up your leg to the battery pack radio receiver thingy that's strapped in an even more intimate area. You become very close, very fast. So, while our sound person, the always warm-handed Kristen, was working her technological magic somewhere between my moobs, she casually said, "Let's put your mic on this side because Lady Gaga will be on your left." Huh? What? You could have knocked me over with the feather. Actually, there was no need to knock me over. I had literally already fallen back on the love seat in my dressing room. That is right. The actual Lady Gaga was going to be sitting right next to me. Little Ross Mathews from Mount Vernon, Washington, at the judges' table. The woman with a million hit songs was giving me a million reasons to need a diaper. Bad
romance? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.